You know why I am here? I am here because I failed my 12th. And when I failed my 12th, मैं कोई भी काम करता हूँ ना तो बहुत शिद्दत से करता हूँ. सो ऐसे वैसे फेल नहीं हुआ मैं कि एक दो मार्क्स ग्रेस हो जाए. आई गॉट 09 आउट ऑफ 100 इन मैथमेटिक्स. हाउ मच? 09 आउट ऑफ 100. आई कुडंट गेट इन टू डबल फिगर्स. एंड आई हैव एक्सपीरियंस्ड फर्स्ट हैंड वॉट आई एम गोइंग टू टॉक अबाउट. एंड इट्स नॉट अबाउट समथिंग दैट आई हैव लर्न फ्रॉम थ्योरी. द टॉर्चर दैट अ स्टूडेंट और अ ह्यूमन बींग अ चाइल्ड गोज थ्रू वैन ही फेल्स इन एन एग्जामिनेशन इन अ कंट्री विच बिलीव्स. In fact, I just shouldn't be saying the country, even the world today, believes that the marks that you get in your exams are the only measurement of how intelligent you are, what you will make of your future, whether you will be a good human being or not. And if that being the only parameter, you churn out degree holders upon tons of them, not knowing what to do with their lives. And this story is so sad. We will try and make it interesting, of course, but I think in the end of these 18 odd minutes that I've got, my whole task is to sensitize you to the fact that not only schools, not only education, the society as a whole wants us to be out there in from one mold. If you're not what they call normal, then you are abnormal. And the moment you're abnormal, then unfortunately you don't fit in. And you don't fit in, then you are not a part of them. So this whole sequence needs to be changed. In fact, the interesting part is that when you grow up and you go into leadership positions, when you go into leadership position, what is your real role? Your role is to figure out how the future is going to turn, understand and try and predict the future and create strategies and create things that will fit into that future. But unfortunately, what we are churning out are people who can't think on their own. Forget looking at predicting the future and trying to mold something out of what you know now to something that will fit into that future. We want our people as leaders to do that, envision and adapt, but we cut their wings when they are children and tell them not to think and repeat what the teacher tells you. So this is the story of that kind. And that's why my title is, Why Are We Bent Upon Killing Creativity? So this was me in school. I was a fish and I was expected to fly. Now, I have something called arithmophobia. That means the fear of numbers. I could never figure out figures that didn't walk on two legs all my life. Even today, I don't figure out numbers. I've never read a balance sheet. I run a successful advertising agency, but ask me about numbers and I get scared. I tell my accountant, I've been very fortunate to have good financial people with me, and therefore I don't have to look at numbers. I tell them, look, ye credit kiya, debit kiya, don't tell me all that. Do we have to take money from him or do we have to give him money? Just tell me that and I'll sign whatever check you want me to sign. That's about the business I know. But while you're in school, you're expected to know all those subjects equally well. People are not cut out that way. God didn't send us to the planet as that, to be able to understand history, geography, English, we had Sanskrit, mathematics, physics, chemistry. We're not created uniformly, and how do you expect us to pass through that system which was developed incidentally, not for creating children who could think? It was never created. If you go back and look at the history of education, it was created to build army of clerks who could fill in forms and adhere to a system which was to service the king. That was how the education system was developed. And we still unfortunately follow the same system. We don't want our students to think. That is the whole problem in life. And from here, when you move, I want to play a small game with you. Are you ready for the game? Jor se yes bolo yaar. Yeah, that's it. What do you see here? A dot. This is exactly what an education system has done to you. Welcome. I know you're all graduates and postgraduates now or about to be that. The same question was put to kindergarten, KG students, you know. And this is mentioned in a book called, a book on creativity, I'm forgetting the name, The Back on the Side of Your Head. This experiment is mentioned there. This was shown to kindergarten students, and you know what? They came up with more than 50 answers to this. Someone said it looks like a squashed bug. Someone said it looks like the tip of a cigarette which my father smokes. Someone said it looks like a pole when seen from the air. So you have 50 different answers for this. And what has education done to us? Given us one right answer. That's the whole predicament. Does it sink in? One right answer. The whole schooling system tells you, if you don't know the right answer, it's better to keep quiet rather than give a wrong answer. Sahi nahi huye chalega, galat nahi hona. They drill that fear into you. And once that is drilled into us, do you expect our students to take risks, take chances in right? In fact, whatever has been invented and discovered till date, okay, has been done because of failures. America was a huge failure that was discovered, right? The biggest example of a failure. Christopher Columbus was not looking for America. And they do seem like a huge mistake today, right? America? It better be not discovered. But anyways, that's another point. look at Edison. He failed 1,000 times when he was making the electric bulb. Had he stopped the first time around and his mom was an Indian and told him, "Nahi nahi beta, galti ho jayegi, nahi karna." Would we have electric bulbs today, or will we be still sitting in dingy halls with lamps hanging all over? Failure is your stepping stone to success. And I don't say this because I failed. I came here as an example. They're setting me, putting me up here as an example. Ye fail ho sakte ho. ठीक है, तो फेल होना बुरी बात नहीं है. जिंदगी को फेलियर को फेटल समझ लेना बुरी बात है. यू कैन ऑलवेज बाउंस बैक. नाउ लास्ट टाइम आपका जमीन पे लेटे थे, आकाश की ओर देखा था और बादलों में बादल नहीं दिखे थे. क्या दिखा था, क्या क्या नहीं दिखता था, पूरी सृष्टि दिखती थी उसमें हमें. दिखती थी कि नहीं दिखती थी? कब लेटे थे ऐसे आप? क्यों नहीं, बड़े हो गए इसलिए. अनदर इश्यू, विल टॉक अबाउट दैट. And the best example that I can give you of how children are always, they are born creative. All of us were born creative. We were made non-creative, and that's the tragedy. This is a sunset, right? There are clouds and there is a sunset. We saw a similar sunset about 25 years ago when I was with my son. We were in Goa. We were in a Maruti van going on those long roads in Goa. And far on the horizon, my son spotted this clouds and a yellow sun over them. He said, "Look, Papa, dekho." I said, "Kya hai?" So he said, "Look, sunset." Educated guy. Yehi bol sakta hai, sunset. He said, "Nahi, Papa, half ride aega, dekho, niche white, upar yellow." And then I could see through his eyes. Children see so many things in these clouds, and we grow up and see, we don't even see the clouds anymore, forget it. We are so busy with our mobile phones. All of us now, in fact, unfortunately, even the children today, all right, that we forget to see what can be seen. Now, this is a very interesting experiment. It is mentioned in one of the books again. I keep forgetting the name. At 61, you're expected to forget half the things, so don't worry too much. I can claim a senior citizen benefit anytime, all right. So, this is a very interesting experiment. So, what happened, this gentleman who's written this book, he says, when I went to a school inspection, incidentally, he's the guy who's a watercolor artist, and his book called North Light is very famous. So, I know something about it. I'm forgetting his own name though. So, he went to this school, and he says, when I was taken into the class one, grade one, and I asked, how many of you are artists here? He says, instantaneously, students leapt out of their seats, hands up, mehu, I'm the one. All right? And then he says, I went to grade two, and asked, how many of you are artists here? Well, about 50% of the hands went up. Then I went to the third grade. So out of 30, about 10 hands tentatively went up, about shoulder high, not higher than this. And then I went to grade six. And I asked, how many of you are artists here? He says, only about 2 students very grudgingly raised their hands. So people who were in kindergarten, the children, they all believed that they were artists. By the time they reached grade six, they had become closet artists. Jo honge, wo bhi nahi bol rahe honge. They became closet artists. Have you heard of a closet engineer, closet doctor? No. Why should there be closet artists then? Why should artists fear saying that I'm an artist with pride today? At least in our country. Okay? Now, I'll tell you the reason for that. Before that, that's Einstein. And he says that whatever I have invented, the inspiration of it has not come, and these are his words, from physics and mathematics classes. The inspiration has come from the drawing and painting and music classes that I attended as a child. That's Einstein saying this for you, all right? This is Alvin Toffler, who wrote The Future, again, forgetting names again. So he says, our education system is a second-rate factory-style organization pumping out obsolete information in obsolete ways. Schools are simply not connected to the future of the kids they're responsible for. This is how we have created our education system, unfortunately. We are pumping out obsolete knowledge to obsolete students to go out into the world, which is expected to adapt to what is happening now, right now. You know what? Another interesting bit of research is students in the classroom are structured. At home, everything is structured. In fact, even if the mom is taking, we call them helicopter moms, telling them, taking them to art class, music class, soccer class, whatever classes, everything in their life is structured and disciplined. What is the only free time that a student gets? If his parents are not very rich and he's traveling by bus, school bus, then this. Otherwise, even that time becomes structured in the car with parents, all right? So students were asked, children from school, where do you have the most fun and the best time? And they said, in the school bus. The tragedy is parents are giving lakhs of rupees as fees to put them in the best of the schools, and they're not having a good time there. They're having a good time in a rickety bus, because there they're unmonitored, unstructured, unsupervised. They're having a ball there. Can't we make schools like that? Can't we make schools like that, that they have fun in the school, so much fun that they don't want to come home? That would be school I want to attend, and I'll not fail there, I promise. What happens is, right from childhood, they're taught and they're made to regimentize. So right from your uniform system to all the cues that you make them form from going from one point to the other. You know, you see nice little, it's like grade 2, grade 3 children, cue all the buttocks in one row when you see from behind. One set of buttocks comes out, gets a cane back in the row. That's how you regimentize them. Through and through, as they grow up, they become more and more regimentized, more and more fearful of expressing themselves, more and more fearful of being anything but normal. And anything that is normal is not creative, unfortunately, because that's average. You want to be creative. And what happens, unfortunately, again, is when they grow up and they come to workshops like we run, which is basically how to enhance creativity. So we charge 50 grand a day for creativity workshop, which was a natural trait given to us, again, to relearn or uneducate themselves from what they have baggage that they're carrying here and become natural again. That's the whole thing we do in that creativity workshop. So regimentization. Now, there's another very interesting story of Gillian Lynn. Unfortunately, मतलब ये होता नहीं है, एक के साथ हुआ तो इतिहास बन गया, and that's why I'm giving you this story. This girl in the 1930s, in her school, she was very fidgety. She couldn't stay still. She couldn't stay and, you know, listen to things. She was always doing something or the other. Teachers were always disturbed. The teachers complained to the principal. The principal complained and looked around, and just, this girl was uncontrollable. She was always moving. Okay, she couldn't still sit still at all. So then what happened was the principal wrote to the mother saying that your child is uncontrollable. We can't control him in the school. Either you do something about it or we will have to remove her from the school, and please send her to some other kind of school for specially abled or something. Mother, sensitive, she took her to a psychologist. The psychologist was a very wise man, fortunately for this lady here. So psychologist looked at her, asked her to wait in the room, spoke separately to mother for about half an hour, understood the whole thing, and then she said, look, we'll leave the child here, we'll go out and talk. And that was strategic. So then he went to the child, the girl, Gil, and said, look, you sit here for 5 minutes, we're going out to discuss something, we'll come back in and talk to you. She says, okay. Now, while going out, he put on the radio on a decent volume, and then the mother and the psychologist walked out of the hall. And then they went to because it was his office, he knew where was what, near a window, and said, just watch what is going to happen. As both of them left, music started playing, this girl started swaying to the music. And gradually, she started dancing. And her dance was so graceful that both of them were mesmerized. And till the time they were standing outside, she was dancing inside full time. And then he came in and switched off this thing and told the mother, can't you see this? Your child is a dancer. She is not meant to rote learn mathematics and philosophy or whatever, English, etc. She's a dancer. She was put into the dance school. She went on to join the Royal School of Ballet. She went on to become one of the most famous musicals producer of the history. She's produced some of the most famous and most rocking musicals in the New York and UK then after that. And her name, you can Google even today, is Gillian Lynn. What happens is, there are some people who can only learn when they are moving. That's called kinetic learning. And some of us can still and learn. Now we call it, we give new names to all kinds of stuff. We call it ADHD. Okay. Unfortunately for her, this word had not been invented till then, and people, doctors didn't have a word called ADHD, otherwise they would have labeled her ADHD and give her Ritalin, medicine for that. How many of the students who could be this lady are being tortured today and be given medication and kind of fishes made to fly and birds made to swim? That's what we are doing in our schooling system, and that's what society is doing to make us less creative. The whole idea is, how do you kill curiosity? Now, this is the other way. It should be the other way around, that schools should be places where you could nurture curiosity, while what they become is, they become places where you kill curiosity. In a class, if a student starts really asking, ye kyun hai, aisa kyun hai, aisa kyun hai, what does that student, you tell me, what do we do with that student? He disturbs everyone else. Either he should be asked to keep quiet, chucked out of the class, or if it still doesn't improve, expelled from the school. So everything is done. Every child is born curious. Paida hote bolne lagta hai to har cheez. Jab bol nahi sakta hai to muh mein dal ke dekhta hai. Uske paas ek hi sense organ hai jo usko duniya ko samajhne ka uska tarika hai, wo muh hai. To har cheez muh mein dalta hai. Muh mein dalte dalte jaise jaise bolne lagta hai, muh mein dalna band karta hai, poochne lagta hai. Hum itna jhalla jate hain uske poochne the ki hum usko mobile phone pakda dete hain aajkal. Ab phir jab wo bada hota hai bolte hai din bhar mobile mein laga rehta hai. What are we even wanting to do? Do we even ourselves know what do we want from our children? So we kill the curiosity. ये एक बहुत interesting चीज़ है. And then comes this caste system. I'm not talking about the Indian caste system. I'm talking about the caste system of subjects. आप कोई भी स्कूल में जाइए. Okay. Now if there is the Brahmans of subjects, it's mathematics. Whichever student is very good in mathematics, you know, वो बिल्कुल ऊपर है सबसे. देन कम दी वैश्यस, और नहीं क्षत्रिय आते हैं पहले, क्षत्रिय आते हैं पहले, ओके मैं थोड़ा सा कंफ्यूज रहता हूँ, क्षत्रिय आते हैं. दे आर योर साइंसेस, फिजिक्स, केमिस्ट्री, बायोलॉजी, ओके. देन थर्ड लेवल पे आते हैं वैश्यस ह्यूमैनिटीज, ज्योग्राफी, हिस्ट्री, एंड द लास्ट कुछ बचा है, ओके, हम जैसे अनटचेबल्स, ओके, इज म्यूजिक, आर्ट, पेंटिंग, ऑल ऑफ दैट. नाउ टेल मी, इफ अ स्टूडेंट इज नॉट गुड, एक नॉर्मल पेरेंट की बात कीजिए, इफ इज नॉट गुड एट मैथमेटिक्स बट इज वेरी गुड एट आर्ट, व्हाट डू यू थिंक अबाउट हिम? जिंदगी में क्या करेगा? जिंदगी में क्या करेगा यार? जिंदगी जिएगा या नहीं ये तो सोचो कभी. अगर बहुत अच्छा इंजीनियर बन गया, उसको इंटरेस्ट नहीं है, इंजीनियरिंग में कर रहा है और मजा नहीं आ रहा है, जी रहा है क्या वो? इस प्रश्न का किसी ने उत्तर दिया है आज तक? आई वॉन्ट टू आस्क दिस क्वेश्चन. आई वॉज वेरी फॉर्चुनेट, आई फेल्ड इन टू अ प्रोफेशन दैट आई लव्ड बिकॉज आई वॉज वेरी गुड एट, आई एम नॉट सेइंग गुड, आई एम सॉरी, आई शुड बी नॉट सेइंग दैट माई self praise, but I love what I do. So every morning is not a chore for me. I'm 61 today and I go happily to my office even this every morning, even now. Okay, that's retirement for me in a way. So what I'm trying to say is, yeah, there is more to life than just becoming a money making machine, because our whole education system again is designed to create and produce money making machines, nothing else. Hum pehli cheez party mein kya baat karte hain? Kitni salary pe laga? Parents ikhatta hote hain, mera bachcha US mein isme kaam kar raha hai, Merrill Lynch mein, 5 crore की सैलरी है इसकी, 10 लाख की उसकी, 15, जिसकी बेचारी की सैलरी कम होती है उसको लगता है मैं तो फेल ही हो गया जिंदगी में. मतलब आर वी लुकिंग एट ह्यूमन बींग्स? या जैसे आज इन आदित्य टुक मी टू द गौशाला एंड ही वाज शोइंग मी द काउज, ये नंदी है 9 लाख, या ये यहाँ की है गिर गाय 2 लाख. तो हम जानवरों की बात कर रहे हैं, जानवर के साथ भी नहीं करते हम कई बार, इंसानों की बात कर रहे हैं यार. पैसा कितनी अहमियत रखता है? 2 वर्ष की रोटी तो देता है और एक कार देता है, और क्या दे देगा जिंदगी में? खुशी दे रहा है क्या? खुशी होती अगर जिंदगी में तो कारों में चेहरे इतने उदास नहीं होते. हकीकत तो ही है, एंड वी स्टिल डोंट वांट टू एक्सेप्ट दिस रियलिटी ऑफ लाइफ. और एक और बहुत बड़ी विडंबना जो हमारे देश के साथ ज्यादा है, कुछ लोग मुझसे अग्री नहीं करेंगे, यू हैव टू टेल मी द टाइम. मैं संजय उवाच वाले से आता हूं, मैं 18 अध्याय भी नहीं मिला रुकता नहीं हूं. Alright. So authoritative figures in our country, the whole thing about guru shishya parampara, pay respect to the elders. So we right from childhood again, you know, it's designed to not question the authority. You can't question authority. Now this is the world system, and therefore we went from being the most evolved society at one time to today, where hardly any innovations of our own happen. We blindly ape the West. Why? Because you can't question the elders. You can't question the teachers. Who else would you question, man? If today, you know, Lord Kelvin ka ek quote hai, heavier than air flying machines are impossible. Lord Kelvin, imagine, jiski hum physics mein law padhte hain, Kelvin's law. He said, heavier than air flying machines are impossible. Had the Wright brothers listened to him, we wouldn't have a plane today, right? Why listen? Every authority has been proven to be wrong at some point or the other. So there's no problem. You don't disrespect authority if you don't question him. In fact, you respect him more when you question him. So the whole idea of this Indian ethos of not, you know, paying respect to elders if you question their authority is wrong, number one. And then our offices are the same. Now I can go on and on because time is short. So our offices are designed to be non-creative. Cubicles, jails, you put them in, timer, gale mein ab to patta bhi dal diya hai, which was only on put on prisoners once upon a time. Everything is so structured, and if you don't, and you have to listen to the boss, you have to please the boss. If you don't follow his philosophy, you're thrown out of the system. Well, the whole system is designed to not let you think and do what you want to do, but follow someone else. Everything, yeah, I've just talked about this. This is Charles Dahl. Everything that can be invented has been invented. He said this in 1889. He was a chairman of patents. Agar iska sun liya hota to 89 ke baad koi patent nahi hota, koi development nahi hota. Please learn to question authority. The horse is here to stay, but the automobile is only a novelty of fad. This is a banker said this to Henry Ford when he was inventing the car. A horse cart is for always. Car is a fad. What are we doing now? Where's the horse cart now? Question, and always question. I said this, but the solution is to have 2 kinds of balls here in your mind. So if you are an expert at one thing, so very good. Keep learning more and more about that one area. So all that is one area, one color of ball. So if you're a physicist, you'll know everything about physics. But then along with that, you need another jar where you have all the other information that is not in your physics. All right. And when the combination of these two happens, that's where creativity is sparked. And if curiosity is the mother of invention, I'll leave you with my last quote. Frustration is the father of creativity. If you're not frustrated with the status quo, jo aaj ho raha hai galat hai, main isko tod ke badlunga, creativity nahi ho sakti. Ye bahut simple si baat hai. Thank you so much for being so patient, so kind of you. Thank you.